Hi, I'm Joel, and welcome to my second video. In this series, we've been sketching the big picture of COVID, and for the next few minutes, we'll be looking at myths and misconceptions about death rates, herd immunity, who ends up in hospital, comparisons with the flu, and more. If you don't know much about health research and epidemiology, I highly recommend checking out my first video, where we go over some basic concepts. We'll be waiting here for you when you get back. Let's start off by rewinding to those early days of COVID-19. This important paper from the Chinese CDC spotlighted the high fatality rates and the even higher fatality rates in older adults. Overall, across 72,000 cases, 1 in 50 died, and in older adults, over 1 in 10 died. Then, in the outbreaks in Italy and New York City, the case fatality rates were just as bad or worse, rising to a staggering 38% in those over 75 in New York City. This CDC report also included the hospitalization rate, which highlighted the terrible strain COVID could place on the health system. For example, 25% of middle-aged adults with confirmed COVID ended up in hospital. Now, I can hear you skeptics out there saying these are big overestimates of the true fatality rate, or what we would call the infection fatality rate. There are many who only show mild symptoms or no symptoms and then never get tested. And that, I would say, is a great point. If you want to get fancy, this would be called ascertainment bias. But I can reassure you that the possibility of this bias was not lost on epidemiologists. Way back in March 2020, the now famous Anthony Fauci wrote, "If one assumes that the number of asymptomatic or minimally symptomatic cases is several times as high as the number of reported cases, the case fatality rate may be considerably less than 1%. The case fatality and hospitalization rates were invaluable in those early days of COVID in planning the response. But what the epidemiologists and you skeptics out there would have loved to have known was not the case fatality rate, but the infection fatality rate. To know the infection fatality rate, we first needed to know the true prevalence of coronavirus infections in the community, and this information unfortunately took many months to gather. If you want an explanation of these terms, see my first video. It has been abundantly clear for some time that there are a substantial number of asymptomatic cases. Just how many? Well, in September, it was estimated at 40 to 45%. Here we encounter myth number one, that the high number of asymptomatic and minimally symptomatic cases means that COVID isn't really a big deal. The irony is that almost the exact opposite is true. If there were few asymptomatic cases, as was the case for some of the other deadly coronaviruses, such as the 2003 SARS coronavirus or the Middle East Respiratory Syndrome coronavirus, it would have been much easier to control. We may not have needed lockdowns or mask mandates. We may have controlled it just by telling people who are feeling ill to stay at home. If it weren't for the asymptomatic cases, this coronavirus may have had the short career that SARS-1 and MERS had. The truth is that asymptomatic and pre-symptomatic people drive infection. It is well established that they account for at least 50% of the spread. The other big problem is immunity. Asymptomatic infections trigger comparatively weak immune response. Yet unpublished results from the massive and well-conducted REACT2 study in the UK found high rates of antibody decline in those who were only asymptomatic. This suggests only transient immunity to future infections. If that's true, those same people may again become asymptomatic spreaders in the future waves of COVID. Incidentally, waning immunity is the reason why even those who have had COVID should get vaccinated, but we'll talk about that more in another video. So what is the infection fatality rate when we take into account all those asymptomatic and minimally symptomatic people? This is where you must be very careful not to cherry pick your favorite IFR study to find a high or a low value that suits you. Fortunately, in epidemiology, we have a tool called meta-analyses. That's where you carefully review the results of multiple studies, assess them for bias, and statistically combine them to find a more accurate estimate. If that sounds like a lot of work, that's because it is. A study last fall in the International Journal of Infectious Diseases found that the average IFR across the population was about 0.7%. But they also found significant variation between the individual studies in their estimates of IFRs. Why is this? Well, as we saw, the IFR will vary widely based on the characteristics of the population that you study. If you have a country with only 80-year-olds, the IFR will be really, really high. On the other hand, the IFR would be really low if you had a country with only 20-year-olds. Fortunately, Levin and colleagues performed another meta-analysis looking at exactly this issue. Looking at 113 studies from 35 geographical locations, they confirmed this exponential relationship between age and the infection fatality rate. A very small proportion of young adults, a not insignificant number of middle-aged folks, and then a staggering number of older adults will die. Indeed, age is emerging as the single most important factor in mortality. Compared to age, the presence of other comorbidities probably has a relatively minor effect on mortality. Now that we've established the infection fatality rate, let's consider what happens if we let COVID run its course. No masks, no burdensome physical distancing, while we wait for the natural immunity to build up. Unfortunately, that really quite diabolical idea has been tested to the full with devastating results in a city in Brazil. There, the COVID-19 epidemic ran totally out of control with very limited public health measures. The cemeteries and health services were completely overwhelmed. A full 76% of the population became infected in a matter of months, and the scary thing is that herd immunity was still not fully attained. This leads us to myth number two, that waiting for natural immunity is a reasonable option. We can see this clearly if we put the infection fatality rates into a better perspective. If you're a history buff like me, you've probably visited a military cemetery like this one in Normandy, where the deadly D-Day landings were. It is a sobering experience to walk through the row upon row of graves. Now let's see how COVID stands up against the great wars of American history. First, the Civil War, with its 655,000 combat and non-combat deaths. Then World War I, World War II, the Vietnam War, and now COVID-19, which has killed 525,000 Americans to date. We see that COVID holds its own rather well against those beaches of Normandy. Now, what happens if we let COVID run its course in America, like it did in that city in Brazil? Using age-specific infection fatality rates, US Census data, and a really conservative estimate of a 70% attack rate, it amounts to almost 3 million people. It dwarfs all those other major combats in American history when you combine them all. A quick word about myth number three, that people dying of COVID-19, directly or indirectly, would have died anyway from other causes. This is absolutely not true. To see this, let's look at excess deaths this past year. Excess deaths is the difference between how many people died this year compared to how many people we would have expected to die this year if 2020 had been like any other year with people dying from heart attacks, cancer, car accidents, and the like. The solid and dashed lines in this graph show the expected number of deaths based on previous years, and we can see that the number of actual deaths far exceeded it. Interestingly, when you dig down into the data, it actually becomes clear that we may be underestimating the number of deaths from COVID-19. Also, let's not forget the indirect deaths due to COVID, which would include things like deaths due to healthcare shortages or overburdened healthcare systems. We saw those crazy hospitalization stats earlier. When hospitals are overflowing with COVID patients, the person who comes in with a heart attack may not get the care they otherwise would get. When we break excess deaths down by age, we see it in every age group. But the largest percentage increase in deaths was actually in the younger to middle-aged population. At the height of the summer wave, 50% more 25 to 44-year-olds died than in previous years. This leads us to myths 4 and 5, that previously healthy people don't get seriously sick and die, and that COVID is no worse than the flu. Myth 5 has always interested me because I think people underestimate just how dreadful the influenza virus actually is when you let it loose in a vulnerable population. Read, for example, about the great influenza pandemic in 1918. So to compare COVID to the flu is actually to say that COVID is really, really bad, which is the exact opposite of what most people mean. But I digress. We saw a few minutes ago that many, many more people will be hospitalized than will die. So let's look at hospitalizations. And who are those people getting sick? They are not, I repeat, they are not simply those with other diseases, what we call comorbidities. While diseases like obesity do increase your risk of being hospitalized and dying, you can still get seriously sick at a healthy weight with no serious health conditions. These two tables show the BMI breakdown of hospitalized patients in the US and critical care patients in the UK. Fully 1/5 to 1/4 of patients were at a healthy weight. Then we can look at how many patients in the ICU with COVID had serious pre-existing conditions. It's pretty small, only 8%. By comparison, 18% of patients with non-COVID viral pneumonia, for example, those caused by the flu, had serious comorbidities. Finally, we can look at functional status of the patients. 9 out of 10 COVID patients were able to live independently before hospitalization. Other countries have similar results, such as this recent study from my hometown. Compared to hospitalized patients with the flu, hospitalized patients with COVID had 3.5 times the risk of death and 1.5 times greater use of the ICU. And pause to realize that almost 1/4 of patients in the ICU were younger than 50. Now, if you're outside the medical world, ending up in the intensive care unit may not sound like much, but it's really nothing to trivialize. This is what it's like to be in prone position in the ICU. You've got multiple IVs coming out of both arms, monitoring straps across your body, attached to multiple machines, and you're likely intubated. For those who don't know what intubation is, it's where we need to hook you up to a machine to help you breathe. We put a device down your throat to visualize the vocal cords, and then insert an endotracheal tube between those cords to the level of your lungs. And then we hook the tube up to a ventilator that helps move air in and out of your lungs. It's a routine and relatively safe procedure for specialists, but for the patient, it's less than ideal. It's also important to realize that surviving hospital isn't the end of your journey with COVID. Getting discharged from the ICU isn't like going home from summer camp, where you're a little tired but basically fine. You may face months of cognitive impairments and physical and mental health challenges and require a prolonged period of rehab and physical therapy. And then there's the yet poorly understood problem of COVID long haulers, which is the focus of much current research. In one recent study, 76% of patients discharged from hospital had at least one symptom 6 months later, with fatigue or muscle weakness being most common. And finally, to end this video, I want to clear up some misunderstanding regarding surge capacity. Why can't we simply open more field hospitals and add ICU beds to accommodate all the extra patients? Well, there are many challenges to doing this, but one of the key ones is finite human resources. For example, your likelihood of surviving the ICU depends heavily on the skill and experience of your dedicated ICU nurse. Standard practice is a 1-to-1 ratio of nurses to patients, since there is so much involved in managing the care of critically ill patients. Unfortunately, you can't train ICU nurses overnight. At the autumn COVID peak in central London, each trained ICU nurse had to tend to 4 patients, assisted by nurses largely unfamiliar with critical care. And if I may say with typical British understatement, that is not ideal. We've reached the end at last, and thanks so much for sticking with me. I'm sorry this video has been so bleak, but I wanted to lay it out for you unambiguously what's so bad about COVID and to clear up as many myths as possible. Please do give us a thumbs up if you found it helpful. These videos are a lot of work to research and produce, so we'd love to hear how they've helped. In our coming videos, we'll review the state of the evidence about masks, vaccines, and more. See you then.